All right, so I have the pleasure of talking with Joel from Killswitch Engage, but more importantly today, he is from Brothers Born.
That's awesome.
It's been, shit, 3 years, 4 years almost,
yeah.
Since Knife Wounds came out.
Yep.
I hear through the grapevine, i.e. your brother, a new one's coming out soon.
Yes, it's almost done. We had to pump the brakes a little bit. Our the other guy in the band, Mike, just had his first little one. So, we're just going to take a little time, let him be a dad for a while.
What, because there wasn't really a whole lot of press, unfortunately, around the release of Knife Wounds.
Yep.
So what kind of inspired the beginning of the band, the project?
Honestly, man, it was just really me and Mike hanging out. Like, he was friends with my wife. She bartended at a bar down the street. And it's like, hey, you guys should chat. We started hanging out, having beers together. And I think he had asked me if I could demo a song, record a demo for him. So we did that at the house. And then I was like, hey, I got a song you should sing on. And that was it. And we started writing songs together.
Do you kind of look to something? I mean, because the interesting thing is like, you know, I don't think fans of Killswitch would be drastically shocked to see you do something in this vein with the kind of interludes that you kind of fool around with on all the Killswitch records that have been omnipresent on every single one.
Yep.
But what does Brothers Born scratch the itch of creatively for you that maybe Killswitch doesn't, since you kind of dip into that a little bit?
I think it just kind of, it's a nice outlet for me to play all the styles of music I like that aren't metal, you know? Just acoustic stuff, there's kind of like some classic rock stuff, there's a little bit of 80s vibe to it.
Having just seen Mark play over at the Zippo Sessions and him putting out a solo record, which is a little bit, it's not so much that it's not Mark Morton, like you wouldn't be like, wow, I never saw this side of him coming with the solo record, but having seen him kind of play more acoustically, where it feels like what I think is more in Mark's wheelhouse of if you were to go hang out with him and what he wants to play, more sitting with an acoustic literally in his lap and just kind of jamming. Would you like to do something more like that at some of these events and kind of do a Brothers Born thing in that capacity and kind of showcase it a little bit more than what you've gotten
to? Yeah, possibly at some point. I mean, like I said, Mike and I, you know, we obviously both travel for work. You know, you used to work for AMCI, you travel for all the, you know, do car events and stuff like that. So a lot of times when I was home, he was gone and vice versa. So that's part of the reason it's taken us so long to make this next record. We just weren't, like, there was a good year and a half where we just weren't home at the same times. But it would be fun. It'd be fun to do some shows.
I was going to say, I do know that you have like a home studio and you record bands and so forth. With kind of the less intensive writing schedule or process it would take to record a Brothers Born song, are you constantly writing stuff even when on the road, like just jamming out? Or do you kind of like to separate that from when you're on the road and just kind of do that when the time is right and working together?
I think we kind of just do it when the time is right. There's never been any kind of like schedule for us to, hey, we're going to sit down and write today. Or just like, it's always just about hanging out, you know, hanging in my basement, smoking and drinking or something, and strumming a few chords. Like, hey, I got this part that can go after that. And it happens pretty naturally, I think.
I was going to say, I was pleasantly surprised when Tyler was talking about how you guys were starting this project. I honestly thought it was you and Tyler doing something, hence the name of Brothers Born.
A lot of people say, hey, how's your brother from Brothers Born? Like, it's not actually my brother. We might as well be at this point.
But, right.
You know?
Has there ever been thoughts of integrating Tyler into it?
Yeah, we've talked about that. Because we have kind of a rotating band, sort of. We have a bunch of friends that play with us. You know, Mike and I have done acoustic shows, just the two of us. We have a bunch of guys that kind of, you know, pop in. Whoever's around will play, you know, bass, drums, additional guitar. So I think Tyler would fit the bill for bass and guitar. I've talked to him about that before. So
I was going
to
say, I know you have filled in for City of Holmes a couple of times.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Tyler has filled in for Killswitch.
Yeah.
And it's funny to see you both playing because it's like you have a very similar style between the playing, the presentation of playing on stage, yeah, and so forth. So it's one of those that seems like it should just naturally happen at some point too.
It's funny, man. My parents came out to that City of Holmes show where I filled in on bass. My mom took a video, and it's just hilarious looking at the two of us. It's like the same person standing next to each other.
Yeah,
yeah, it's hilarious.
He ruined a part of one of the Killswitch songs for me. He told me that on was it Arms of Sorrow, that Adam D's part in that was actually supposed to be Vallow's. And it just didn't work out scheduling-wise. And I think it was that song. And ever since then, he's always, like, after he told me that, I was like, I can't not hear potentially, like, a big like hymn chorus on that from that
I'm
spot.
I'm not sure I ever knew that was supposed to happen.
Oh, he told me that you were the one who told him that. Well, maybe he's talking out of his ass.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Who knows?
You know, kind of speaking to, not necessarily the new Killswitch record, but is it interesting to find Killswitch fans kind of at the Brothers Born show? Do you find that they are there solely because it's you from Killswitch, or do you tend to find that people are actually coming out really enjoying what Brothers Born is doing and supporting that?
You know, I've really found on the few shows we've done, it really seems like it's kind of its own thing.
Yep.
Like, 'cause it's not, I mean, I think there's, you know, a handful of Killswitch fans that might dig it, but it's definitely a pretty big departure. So it's sort of a separate thing, man.
It is. It's funny because, like, I remember going to see The Damn Things, if you are familiar with them at all. And so that's one of Keith's, like, bigger side projects. But he had another one before that called Finale. And it was more of an acoustic-y folk kind of thing. And I remember going to Detroit to go see him play, and there was, like, maybe 15 of us there. Clearly, everyone was an Every Time I Die fan. But the weird thing was, is, like, everyone didn't know any of the material. They were just kind of standing there, arms crossed, like, all wearing Every Time I Die shirts. And it was very weird to be the only pseudo-fan of that band, like, where I knew all the lyrics to stuff being played. And I was like, it's cool you're all here, but you're not, it doesn't seem like, it seems like you as the artist have to traverse and train people to be like, it's really awesome you're here as a Killswitch fan, but this really isn't Killswitch.
Yeah, I'm sure, I think when the Knife Wounds came out, probably a few people scratching their heads a little bit when they heard it, like, whoa, what's this? This is not what I expected.
Maybe
that's good for some people, maybe not for others.
Well, I was going to say, do you look at someone maybe like a Dallas Green who kind of came from City and Color, from Alexis on Fire, and then has had a really successful solo career as City and Color, and kind of just musically what he's kind of taken that project and done with it. Do you kind of look at something like that and go like, oh, I feel like maybe it starts off as this thing and maybe we kind of grow it into its own thing? Is that something you would like to do, or do you really want to keep it very kind of compact and niche?
It's really hard to say. I think at this point we're just really, really slowly making this record that we're very proud of. You know, we've been working on it for over a year now. So there's really not much to be done. It needs a few guitar tracks, a few vocals, needs a mix and a master, and then we're kind of there. But I don't really think we have any plans to try to take over the world or anything. We just want to write good music that we like and do some fun shows here and there when we can. And, you know, when life doesn't get in the way, you know.
Kind of switching up gears, I know you guys put out with, I think it was Cigar Boat Brewing, put out the Killswitch beer.
Oh, Cigar City, yeah.
There's Cigar City, yes,
yep.
I'm sorry.
Yep. These guys are awesome.
So, obviously, the name of ours is BREWtally speaking, BREW, so we like to dip into that a little bit. Is there any collaboration in the works to do something again, another run, since that beer seemed to do so well with you guys?
We haven't talked about it recently, but yeah, that beer was fantastic. You guys did a really great job with it. It was pretty high-octane IPA kind of beer. Really, really good.
I was trying to think of the last time we hung out back in GR. I think I asked you what was your go-to beer, if it was like IPA, stouts, porters, whatever. And I think you kind of said you were more like an IPA, but like you like a little bit of everything, depending on your mood.
Yeah, I've kind of changed a little bit over the years. Other than Guinness, I don't really drink a lot of stouts anymore. I love Guinness, though. I drink it all the time. That's usually my go-to beer.
And are you still big onto like whiskey, spirits, and all that kind of stuff?
Not so much. Not so much.
I knew you were a big, Maker's guy? Or Beam?
You still like Beam? Like Canadian Club still. I drink that, but it's, you know, in moderation now. I'm getting too old to be pounding whiskey all the time, but...
Yeah.
But I do enjoy it very much.
In your travels, what's kind of been... You know, because I feel like you're in a unique position to kind of really get a spectrum of what the craft beer boom has kind of done, either here in the States or even abroad. What has been something... Do you feel like the bubble has been burst? And if not, where do you kind of see the... What are some of the breweries you think are kind of really hitting it out of the park with everything they're doing?
Let's see. Well, it's funny. There's one in East Hampton, my hometown, Fort Hill Brewery, that's doing great stuff. An abandoned building. They have, like, a few really awesome breweries just right near where I live. It's great. And it's nice to see some of those awesome IPAs popping up on the East Coast. It's just kind of been a big thing, you know, in the West Coast for years, with, you know, Stone and Lagunitas and a lot of great breweries out there. So it's sort of finding its way over to the East Coast now, which is awesome to see.
It's been kind of crazy to see the New England IPA style starting to make its way.
Yeah.
Like, having gone over to Rhode Island and having never heard of a New England style and trying and being like, this is pretty good.
Yeah.
And then it seems like ever since that trip, I've been seeing everyone starting to do their take on a New England IPA. And so it's kind of interesting to see, very much like with music, regional places putting their stamp on various types of beer. You know, I'm very fortunate to live in Michigan, and Grand Rapids, especially with Founders and Bell's kind of basically being...
Founders is fantastic. Yeah.
And now that they have their own, like, a second brewing to do kind of like the one-offs, we're just inundated with a lot of specialty one-offs that you're just like, I love it.
Bell's does the Two Hearted Ale, right?
That is correct.
That's killer. That's a great beer.
I had seen a billboard in my travels that said that Two Hearted is the number one drank beer in America.
Really?
I don't know if I believe it.
I'm sure I believe it, but it's fantastic beer.
Maybe the one number one craft beer. Because, I mean, and then, like, every show I go to now and I look around and everyone's drinking a Two Hearted, I'm like, you know, maybe. It's like the Bud Light of craft beer at venues, it seems.
Michigan's a fantastic beer state, man. It really is.
Do you get a lot of it? I would assume the distribution for Bell's and Founders, at least, gets down to you.
Yeah, for sure.
What is kind of your go-to beer, you know, when you're out and about, if you can get a craft beer anywhere? What is it?
It depends. Honestly, if we're hanging out, I really like the LD IPA. The Founders is great. We usually have those on the bus because it's pretty low gravity and it tastes great. When I'm at home, I really like the Fort Hill. They do one called the Farmer's.
Does Tyler work there?
What's that?
Doesn't Tyler work there?
Tyler works at Tinbridge. Those guys are coming up. They're making awesome beer, too. Those guys are really kind of only about a year and a half old, I think, at this point. The beers are fantastic. I forgot to mention those guys. They're great dudes.
He keeps sending me photos of beers, and I'm like, where's that from? And he goes, oh, where I work. And I go, can you send me some? It sounds great.
Yeah, fantastic people there and really, really good beer.
What, other than the new Brothers Born record, the upcoming Killswitch record, what are you looking forward to for the rest of this year? And who are you looking forward to seeing tonight?
Honestly, as far as the new Killswitch, I think we're all just really excited to get it out. It's done. We turned it in. We don't have a release date yet, but we should have one soon.
Per the internet, I thought it was like August something.
I think that's what we're hoping for.
Okay.
But we haven't confirmed the release date, so it should
probably got to wait on vinyl and all of those kind of things.
I think that's the big thing. They want to do vinyl at the same time, so we're just kind of waiting to get all that together. We should probably know very soon the exact date, but we were hoping for the summertime initially, so we'll see if we can do that.
And then who are you looking forward to seeing tonight?
It's hard to say. There's a lot of bands. I'm looking forward to seeing Lamb of God. I haven't seen those guys in a while. Gojira, love those guys. Beyond that, I'm not even sure who's playing.
I know Josh was telling me you guys are basically all heading out pretty early in the morning.
Yeah, yeah.
So I didn't know if you guys were like kind of beelining it.
It's going to be kind of an early night for us. Yeah, we're getting, you know, still got to pack up our things. So the tour of Parkway Drive just wrapped up the other day. And so this is the last one for us, and then we're home for a little while.
Awesome. Well, thank you for taking the time, and looking forward to seeing your set tonight. And
thank you, man.
I know you're not going to play anything new, I don't think.
Not just yet.
Not just yet.
Next tour.
And so looking forward to it. Thank you for taking the time.
You got it, brother. Thank you.